use it. I just don't read all the stories. You know, it's a little bit of a cheat if you guys, just so you know. Hi, Mike. I didn't see you come in. It's if you are one of these people that, you know, when the preacher's boring, you don't know what to do. You know, there's a lot of interesting stuff in the Bible, and you can really get away with reading it during church. So just a little tip to those who snore loudly and to wake everybody up when Amen. We're preaching. Read your Bible if you're bored, okay? Or just pay attention if it's worth your while. I'm not saying it always is. Good to see you this morning. Everybody smiling, happy, alive, alert, awake, enthusiastic. Could you please find in your Bibles Revelation chapter 4? And we're going to be looking at one verse there this morning. Verse 11 will be the verse that we're going to find our text in. While you're doing that, I'm going to see if I can get some technological cooperation. Probably won't be able to. Ah. Well, technology doesn't cooperate when you need it to. Everything was fine a couple minutes ago. Okay, Revelation 4 and verse 11. And then before we read our text this morning, I'd like to just promote for you the series beginning in September. We're going to be looking at financial stewardship in September. Brother Lee will be teaching that class, and it will have some elements of class that he's taught before, but we are going to focus on the aspect of stewardship, on the financial aspect in this class, and he's preparing for it now, and we're looking forward to it. And let me promote it to you on several ways. Every Christian ought to be a learner and a grower, and every Christian ought to be taking aspects of their life and letting both the Holy Spirit of God and the Word of God analyze our lives and look to grow and improve. In an area that many Christians have need for improvement is the area of financial stewardship. Most of the people I know weren't taught how to manage finances. Most of the people that I know weren't taught at an early age a biblical philosophy for finances. And so maybe you were, or maybe you've learned some things. Most people I know don't have a budget. Most people I know have an income-outgo budget. In other words, So if they're disciplined without a budget, they don't spend more than they have. In other words, if it's not there, they don't spend it, but that's their budget. But as far as planning, budget is planning how you will spend. As far as that goes, there isn't a lot of planning. And I'll just present a couple of thoughts to you and just to consider. And the reason being is I think this is a class we all need. If no more prayer and thought goes into your finances, then do I have it or do I not have it? There are two problems that you have. First, the first problem is that you're living on a needs, you're living on a supply-based decision. In other words, you're not making a decision on the basis of whether or not God wants it. You're making a decision on whether or not it's a possibility. And even if God wanted it, if it weren't possible, you couldn't do it. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, there'd be some things in your life. You ever felt like, man, I wish I could give? Well, I think a lot of times a wish I could give is a prompting by the Holy Spirit of God. In other words, I'd like to give toward that. Oftentimes, is man, if God's given you a desire to give, and you cannot, well, it's a prompting of the Holy Spirit of God, but you have vetoed God's input by your lack of planning. Okay, that's the first principle. Then the second thing, along with it, would be that, and I should say, tag that and say. So you are making decisions on the basis of whether or not it's possible financially. But the second thing about it is just the very, very simple principle of God's will in your life. If you don't have a budget, you really are belying the truth. In other words, that is a symptom that shows that you're not prayerful in your finances. In other words, you're not considering, well, should this be? Does this belong? Ought I to do this? Is this right or is this wrong? So you're not concerned about the will of God in your finances. And so those are just two considerations, two things. And usually when people think about budgets, they think about restriction. In other words, when the wife comes and says, we need a budget, that means to the husband, I don't want you to spend money on the things you're spending it on. When a husband says, we need a budget, that means to the wife, I don't like the way you're spending money. In other words, sometimes it's used as a responsible word to control the other person. And actually, budgeting isn't anything of the sort. Budgeting is figuring out how to do something. It's figuring out, okay, I'd like to do this. This is a desire. And this is what I'd like to do. And budgeting figures out how to do that. It plans to do things. And that has every bit with, it has way more to do with freedom than it does with restriction. Everybody understand that? Okay, so we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be trying to free our people. Honestly, I don't know how many, there's no way I could know. I couldn't first know the hearts, but secondly, I couldn't keep record of how many people tell me that they think God wants them to do something, and they tell me they're not going to do it. And then they tell me that the reason is financial. And if that's you, well, then we'd like to help you. We'd like you to be free, just free. Free to do things and free to be in the Lord's will. We're going to talk a little bit this morning about something that's similar, but not exactly. You notice we're in Revelation. We've been begun our series in Revelation and really got into our first message last Sunday evening in Revelation. Revelation 4 and verse 11 is a portion of the Scripture, or a verse in the Scripture that I won't be able to preach in our series for sake of time. And so the next couple of weeks I'm going to be looking at a couple of just concepts that aren't necessarily the theme of what we're preaching, but concepts that I think ought to be taught. And so this is one of them this week. Verse 11 of Revelation 4. This is when the four dwelling elders fell down before him and sat on the throne. Verse 11. Thou art worthy. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. And I want to look at the second part of verse 11. For Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. Now we know the chorus, right? Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, hast all things created. Thou hast created all things, and they go on. It's like, you know, turned into a 7-11 chorus, seven words, 11 times, that sort of thing. This is that passage of Scripture where that comes from. So the statement I want to look at this morning is the second part, for Thou hast created all things, and then particularly, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. Now, the word create is something exclusive to God, because the very concept of create, especially in the Hebrew, now obviously this would be in the Greek that this aspect of it is used, but especially, particularly in the Hebrew, the word create means, you know, out of nothing. But it still has that same concept. The word ktizo. K-T-I-Z-O would be the transliterated word, or be the transliteration of it in the English. And literally, it means create. And the word create is sort of like the word baptize, in that it doesn't have a synonym. To describe what baptize means, you have to use several words, because there isn't a word that means what baptism means. To describe what create means, you have to use several words, because there's no word equivalent for create. When we say, you know, we use the word create in our English language, but it's used inaccurately a lot of times. We talk about, well, we'll create a software. Well, no, You don't create software because when you write code or whatever, you do it on the basis of something that's already been made. You take, for instance, code. Well, somebody's already written code. It's already been developed. Language has already been developed. You're making it from something in order to do something. But when something is created, it's literally spoken into existence. The concept of it hasn't even existed. So, I mean, it's not even a conceptual word. Create literally means made from nothing. Nothing that is foundational to creation existed before it created. It was created. Okay, so the Bible says about creation that God has created all things. In the New Testament of the Scripture, the word create is used 9 times. And it has some great meanings as it's used. It has to do with creation, the words that we are created in Christ, a new creature. The spiritual regeneration or the spiritual birth is literally out of nothing. You know, it's created. It's made. Every aspect of it is made by God. Okay, now I don't want to focus this morning on that, but I just want to emphasize the ownership of creation. An individual in any culture who designs something feels ownership, right? Many cultures have more or less patent concepts. The idea of I made it, I designed it, therefore I have the rights to the design of it. If someone else copies it, in some way they need to acknowledge that it's my design. Well, we have that concept, but God has a concept that supersedes that by a lot. In other words, I created it. I didn't take something and make something from it. I didn't take a piece of wood and fashion it. I didn't take some different metals and create an alloy, make an alloy. I didn't take metals and make a design. I didn't make something from something. I made everything about it. So God is the creator of all things and has ownership. And my friend has a jealous guarding or affection or love for that which he has created and his right to have it. Okay, so in heaven, anybody ever bothered by the angels on clouds playing harps? Where'd that come from? Who drew that picture of the, you know, babies with wings and no diaper? Well, you know, like, you know, cloth diaper or whatever. Chuck drew the angels?
Michelangelo, he said.
Oh, Michelangelo did that? Shame on him. Shame, shame, shame on that guy. The idea of ourselves being, one, turned into angels. Actually, we're not angels. We're lower than the angels, but we're going to be made higher than the angels. Literally, the angels will be subservient. They will serve us in heaven. The idea that, or the concept that in heaven, we're going to be really mindless worshipers. That's kind of the way it seems to me sometimes. We're just going to be in heaven, and, you know, we're going to be basking in the glory. And I'm not trying to make a mockery out of the truths that do belong here. We're not going to be in heaven mindlessly, you know, bowing for not thousands of years or millions of years, not trillions of years, for infinity, just bowing and you know, singing over and over again, you know, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive. No, but we will be for eternity acknowledging God's right to us, to heaven, to earth, to everything that's created. The word in Revelation is used again, I believe, in chapter 10. Where is it? That's because I'm looking at chapter 9. Verse 6, and swear by him that liveth forever, who created heaven and all things that therein are, and the earth, and the things that therein are, and the sea, and the things that are therein, that there should be time no longer. So when we see God who created time is going to actually, and again this is in a time of judgment, is actually going to destroy time or eliminate time. When God destroys the heaven and the earth, he's going to be destroying something that's created. But going back to chapter 4 and verse 11, the Bible acknowledges, first of all, God has created all things. And Christian, this may be a struggle for you and for me, but a key to satisfaction, a key to joy in life, a key to happiness, and a key to fruitful productivity in life is the recognition that because God has created all things, He understands the intent. And not only does He understand the intent, but He has the right to expect that we ourselves who are created and have been recreated in Christ Jesus, He has the right to expect that we would perform His intended purpose in our lives. There's just no argument in that, is there? There's no one that would say, well, God doesn't... I mean, I know lost people would, or people that are bitter and angry against God. But in this room, there's no argument that God's intent, His intended purpose in our lives ought to be fulfilled and carried out, right? Okay. God has the right to receive glory and honor and power. And the reason for it is because He's created all things. And the secondary reason is that all things were created for His pleasure. Now I want to just do a study this morning on that word pleasure. Would that be okay? You ever wonder what it means to live to God's pleasure? In other words, according to this scripture, the Bible says that you were created for God's pleasure. Now, isn't that amazing? You were created for God's pleasure. And I know we have verses we quote like, shall the thing formed say unto him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? But Christian, it's not just a matter of you and I ought to have the audacity to question the way God created us or the purpose for which God created us. It is foundational to our finding God's purpose in our lives to understand that we are created for God's pleasure. And I don't know about you, but if you've got a self-esteem problem, that ought to settle it. It ought to solve it. In other words, if you can cause, through realizing His purpose for you in your life, God's pleasure, that's sort of a big deal, isn't it? A lot of times when we think of pleasure, we think of it with a selfish motive. If a young man is courting a young lady and he's planning a date, it makes sense that she ought to enjoy the date, right? Some young men really falter here. Some really young men really fail. In other words, we're going to do something really fun. What do I like? Oh, video games. So he's going to have a video game date with a girl. Let me just clue you in, gentlemen. If a girl wants to go on a video game date with you, it is not for her pleasure. Okay? Now, you'll find girls before you're married who are willing to do things with you that they don't like to do. And the reason for it is they want to please you. But if you really think that a girl's like, yeah, I'd just love to spend time with my guy, bonding over black cops or whatever it is. That's for you, Thomas. You like it. Okay. Anyway, playing whatever, you know, these games where you mutilate and annihilate each other on videos, you know, is that the game that has zombies in it where people sit there and shoot zombies that can never be killed, you can never end, isn't that Black Ops?
Yeah.
That has that. That's stupid, Mike. Isn't that stupid? Play a game you can't win. By the way, don't invite me to that game either, because it wouldn't be for my pleasure either. Okay, so what I'm saying is, if a guy wants to win the good graces of a girl, the motive behind it usually is for his pleasure. In other words, he wants her. He wants her to be his. And it isn't because, you know, at that level he's thinking, you know, laundry, cleaning, cooking, you know, taking care of the things in the house. Although Andrew just sat up straight like, oh, I can get somebody to do my laundry? Cook and clean. Well, hey, this is a good idea. This is for my pleasure. Okay. So, you know, when you go to Chick-fil-A and they serve you, they say thank you, and they say, my pleasure. Right? Well, I don't know if they or you know, if they really mean that or not. But I want to just look at this word pleasure here. The word pleasure, when it comes to God, when it comes to pleasing God, isn't some kind of a circular. In other words, I want to please Him so that He'll please me. A lot of times we play with God this way. You know, when you promise God something, if with a condition, that's for your pleasure, not His. Get it? You ever promise God something with a condition? God, if you get me out of this situation, I'll... You know, well, that's if I get out of this situation, then God... Well, the thing ought to be, God, I regret that in my life it has been about me and what I want. In spite of this situation, you know, because of the situation, I see that I need to be living for your pleasure or whatever. But usually it's a, God, if you'll do this for me, I'll do this for you. And the idea is that this is, you know, for your pleasure, for mine, it's mutually beneficial. And the concept here in heaven is that we weren't created for our pleasure, we were created for His pleasure, for God's pleasure. Now, Christian, you may say, well, Pastor, this doesn't sound like there's anything for me in it. Well, that ought to be the motive. See, the caveat of it is that God is good. See, most of the time we think that God isn't good, and so we, when we do something for God, we have to make sure that we're covered, that we're going to be taken care of. God, if I do this for you, how am I going to be happy? And I just want to submit to you this morning that isn't why we were created. You and I are not created for our happiness. We're created for His pleasure. Okay? Now, I'm not saying we can't be happy. It's hard for me when I'm teaching in Sunday school. It's tough to teach Sunday school because I want to preach my Sunday morning message. It's one of the hardest things that a preacher has to do is knowing what you're going to preach weeks in advance and talking to people and not letting it come out in your conversation, sort of like a spoiler, you know? And it's not because your message is a secret or whatever, but if you preach it ahead of time, what's good is to preach it later. You know, it sounds like it's redundant at that point. It's tough being a preacher. It's one of the hardships of preaching is knowing what you're going to preach and not preaching it ahead of time, not letting it go. Okay, so we're created for God's pleasure. We're going to see a concept that relates to what we're talking about right now in Romans this morning as we begin our series in Romans. You and I would benefit greatly by understanding what the 24 elders in heaven are declaring as they bow before the throne. Thou art worthy to receive glory, honor, and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. These things are created for You, God, period. Now take a guess, what word is synonymous with pleasure? What's a synonym? Means another word that means similar, has a similar meaning. What is a synonym or an alternate translation for the word pleasure? Satisfaction? Nope. Good try.
Joy?
Wouldn't it be makaria?
What?
Wouldn't it be makaria?
No.
Blessed?
No? Yeah, that's blessed. That's happy. That's word for happy or blessed. No.
Obedience?
Nope. Joy? Joy. No.
Delight?
Nope.
Faith?
Nope.
Entertainment?
What?
Entertainment?
God created us. That's the cosmic theos, you know, in heaven. You know, playing the puppeteer in heaven, playing with us. Ah, this is gonna be fun. All right. No, the word for pleasure here is a word that is used for will, thelema, the will of God. And I think it is both appropriate and helpful for us to understand that when God has His will in our lives, there's pleasure in it. How many of you have looked at God's will for your life as though it is a concept that is drudgery? You know, like, well, okay, God created me, I owe Him everything, I should have gone to hell, that'd be worse than doing God's will for my life, so I'm not going to hell, I have eternity in heaven where I get to bow down and worship God for infinity. And so because of not burning forever, you know, it's better to serve God and I'll have fewer dire consequences. And so, God, I want to know what your will for my life is, and I'll do it. I'm telling you, a lot of people, honestly, with the way that the tone about when they're seeking God's will in a thing is more about, I'm going to do the right thing here. You know what I'm talking about? Like, you know, I'm not. It's like going to work on Monday morning. Now, some of y'all may enjoy your jobs, but you don't enjoy it till you get there, at least. Right? In other words, when that alarm goes off, if you're an alarm person, when that alarm goes off, you know, on Monday morning at 6:30 a.m. or whenever it is, and you think, I have to get up. And you do have to get up. I mean, you could not get up, but it would wreck your life and those around you as you know it. And so you have to get up. You have to go to work. And you may actually have a good time at work. There may be good conversation at work. The project may be exciting, exhilarating. You may have something. You may learn something. It may be, you know, I don't know about you, but sometimes I just doing something, I have a good time doing it. So I have a good time doing it with the people. The work's not necessarily drudgery, but the idea of approaching it does seem to be drudgery. And friend, I just want us to understand something about God's pleasure in our lives. That God's pleasure is my pleasure, and that the whole idea, the whole mindset that if I do God's will or if I perform the will of God in my life, then there's going to be some drudgery involved. I love Paul, his illustration. I mean, how many of you realize that Paul was not called to a life of ease? Everybody in agreement about this? Let's talk about Paul for just a minute. Before he was, and he was kind of an intense personality. God, for his pleasure, created him that way. Before he was saved, he was breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord and probably enjoyed it. In other words, there was something about Paul. I mean, he just doesn't seem like, you know, the guy that, well, you know what, I don't want to take things in life too seriously. Right? Paul was a pretty, personality-wise, based on what he did, I get the impression that Paul was a fairly serious fellow. To have studied under Gamaliel, he would have had to have been such an exceptional scholar. The level of his scholarship would have had him excel or exceed all of his peers. So he would have been like the girls in Greek class in college. You have girls in Greek class in college? Charlie, did not let the girls learn Greek.
No, they let them, but they let not them. Very many went.
What kind of grades did the girls in Greek class make?
Very high
grades, right? Highest grades in the class. Yeah, they come in, you know, like reciting the Greek alphabet, seeing how fast they can do it. You know, they're ready for every quiz. They look at the course outline and actually do everything on it and make straight A's. In Greek, you can get straight A, and all you got to do is your work. You know, guys are more like, you know, they meander into Greek class, and hopefully they're conscious enough to catch the concepts. But girls show up, tackle it, and get straight A's. Paul would have been like a girl in Greek. The reason they make straight A's is because they do the work, and the girl's like, this is fun. You know why I took Greek in undergrad? Because I had to. That's why. It was required. It was a good thing for me, and I recognize that, but I took it because I had to. You know why the girls took Greek in undergrad? Because they wanted to. And they thought it was fun. Albeit, I'm sure there are fun aspects of Greek, you know, when the instructor makes jokes or something like that, you know, there's fun things in there somewhere. But, you know, there's just a big difference. Well, that was Paul. Paul was a guy that enjoyed studying, you know, and he stood out among the students. Of course, he had the intellect, but he also had the discipline and the fortitude. I mean, how many guys are going to devote their life to stamping out a faction, you know, of Judaism, the followers of Christianity? You know that, politically speaking, just being Jewish, Paul had enough events. He could have got involved in politics instead of involved in religion. And could have gotten a lot more benefits, personally, from that. The idea that Paul chasing down, hunting down Christians and dragging them, binding them, taking them, you know, back to Jerusalem and so forth, the things that he was involved with, the idea that he did it for personal gain, I don't think is so. Now, he talks about, we looked in Philippians a couple weeks ago, didn't we, about how he said, the things that were gained to me, I count a loss for Christ. So Paul's personality was different than most of us, wasn't it? You know, I don't really see Paul saying, you know, I'd like to just have a relaxing day on the seaside. I could see him, you know, being helped by that, but it didn't seem like, you know, he wouldn't, you know, he was no Charlie Salcedo. Charlie Salcedo's ultimate aspiration in life would be to be a beach bum. Like, if he could just, you know, if he could get showers. I mean, that'd be about the only thing, right? You know, I mean, except for showers. He says it's tougher than you think to shower. You know, they run you off on the beach when you're just living there and showering there. But he said, you know, aside from showering for Charlie, I'm not making this up, this is real. Charlie's like, if he could just shirk all responsibility, get rid of everything and everything that he has to do, and just get rid of all his stuff, and just live on the beach and have, you know, like nothing to do, that would be good. Not Paul. So you understand the way Charlie was made by God and the way Paul was made by God, and I'm not being silly in saying they're both made by God that way for his pleasure, is different, right? So many times you and I look at individuals and we look at what God does in their life and we think the will of God for your life, well, you know, when Paul was saved, you know, they were told that he was going to be an apostle and that he was going to preach Christ to the Jews and to the Gentiles and to the Greeks and in palaces and this sort of thing. And Paul was created for that, and he was the perfect person for it. Well, he was the perfect person for it, and you're not Paul and neither am I. And sometimes when we surrender in our minds to God's will for our life, we surrender to God's will for someone else. And friend, that'll be anything but pleasure. Don't take this the wrong way, and maybe I'll say it the right way so you won't have to. You wouldn't want to be me. And I wouldn't want to be you. You sure wouldn't want to be my wife, because she's married to me. You get what I'm saying? In other words, the same way you look at me and be like, man, I wouldn't want to be like Pastor Price. I look at you and think, I wouldn't want to be like that person. You know what I'm saying? Why? Well, because God created me for his pleasure, and he made me as an individual for his pleasure. And many times when we understand God's will for our life, we take the concept of pleasure and extract it completely and just think it means I have to be like that person. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? Whereas if God called you to the ministry, do you realize that the ministry God called you to is different than the ministry he called me to? It's a different ministry. And God did call you to the ministry. And it could be involved with the same ministry, but not having the same ministry. Ministry means to serve, and God's called me to serve in different ways, and he's called you to serve. And he's done so for pleasure. Now I want to look at some concepts where this word is used. The same word is used in the scripture. Let's just look at it in the New Testament. Matthew chapter 6. And I'm going to turn there. And then someone turn to Matthew chapter 7. And then somebody turn to Matthew chapter 12. I'll tell you what. I'll do Matthew. Let's go to, somebody else go to John chapter 4. Who's John 4? Who'll do John 4? Okay, Mrs. Dowens. And be ready to read verse 30. I'm sorry, verse 34, and then can you handle 3? Chapter 5, verse 30. So John 4, 34, 5, 30, and 6, 38, 39. Or 6, 38 through 40. Okay. All right, we're going to go to Matthew. You ready for those, Mrs. Dullins? Somebody help her with remembering those. 4, 34, 5, 30, and 6, 38 through 40. Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. The scripture says here, thy kingdom come, this is in the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. That's the same word as we see in Revelation 4 in verse 11, for thy pleasure they are and were created. Okay, so here we find a principle that God's pleasure ought to be our pleasure. When we pray to the Lord and we say, God, Give me my daily bread, God. Forgive me of my trespasses, God. Lead me not into temptation. Deliver me from evil. God, I need your Spirit. And God, I need whatever it is we're asking God for. All of that that we're doing when we pray is encapsulated in the idea that it is for God's pleasure. Friend, I'm going to just tell you something. God's pleasure will be your pleasure. You ever hesitatingly submitted to doing something that you knew God wanted, and when you did it, you realized, I actually like this? I have. Soul winning is one of those things for most people. It's one I can think of most easily. God wants everyone to go soul winning. It's amazing how much of a hardship it is for most people to take the 30 to 45 minutes to go out and knock on doors on Monday night. Now I know you got to get there. You got to, you know, there's things that take more, but it really isn't. The soul winning itself is what you're afraid of usually. And it's only for 30 or 45 minutes. And it's amazing how much when you actually do it, you love it. Many times when I've preached the gospel, I have gone away in my mind thinking, this is what I was made for. You know what I'm talking about? Many times after preaching the gospel, I go away and I just think, this is what I was made for. This is why God made me. This is my purpose. And I'm going to tell you something, I liked it. It was my pleasure to do God's pleasure. Concept, you know that the concept everybody understands? Okay, Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Now, is the scripture here indicating that you're saved by God's doing God's pleasure in your life? Well, yes and no. The idea certainly is not that you're saved by works. But it is God's pleasure to save those. It's God's will that no man or that no one should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's God's will that all men be saved. So you understand that it actually pleases God to save people? Well, sometimes we think, well, God wants this, but we don't think God rejoices in this. God is pleased in this. God is thrilled in this. Chapter 12, verse 50 of Matthew. For whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same as my brother and sister and mother. God's will is instrumental in fellowship. God's will is instrumental in fellowship. Fellowship, our fellowship is in, remember in 1 John what it says? Truly our fellowship is with the Father through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus said, if you want to have fellowship, friendship, then do my pleasure, do my will. Matthew 18, verse 14. Even so, it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Now, we know that if a person offends a child, it's better for them a millstone were hanged around their neck and they were cast in the sea. So, it's God's pleasure that children are protected and that they don't perish. John, are we there, Mrs. Dollins? John 4:34. There are more we could look at in Matthew, but
Jesus saith unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work.
Okay, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. This is a message oftentimes I preach the sustenance of serving from. And a matter of fact, Lee tweeted on Fort Lauderdale Baptist Twitter this last week. What'd you tweet, Lee? Something about if you're worn out and tired, it's not from serving God. Something that's not an exact quote, but he tweeted something like that. And it really is true that it is actually a pleasure to serve the Lord. And if you find yourself exhausted to the point where you just can't do anything, you can't go on, it's not because you're serving God, it's because you're not serving God. is God's pleasure. It actually is sustaining. My meat, Jesus said. Here he is. He was famished when he came to Samaria, preaches the gospel to this woman at the well. And he sent his disciples to town to get something to eat. They come back and they're ready to feed him, and he says, "Hey, I'm not hungry." He was so tired he had to sit down at the well and ask a woman to draw from him. And when they came back, he wasn't hungry anymore. And they said, "Did somebody feed him?" And he said, "My food, my meat, is to do the will of him that sent me." If you're not making it, you're not serving Jesus. I'm just telling you, I'm not trying to preach some hard-nosed, you know, force people to do things. I'm just telling you, I found that's true. I have so many physical things to do that if I focus on doing them, it'll absolutely exhaust me. But if I serve Jesus, the physical things will take care of themselves to some degree or won't be taken care of at all, but God's pleasure will be done, and it'll sustain me. I'll make it. Christian, you know, if you're too tired to serve God, you're not too tired to serve God. You're not serving God enough to actually have the energy to do so. Okay, two more, Mrs. Dollins. Let's see, John 5:30 will be the next one.
"I can of my own self do nothing as I hear. I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me."
Okay, so here is Jesus speaking of God's pleasure. It pleased God, the Bible said. Remember this? It pleased God to bruise him. With the chastisement of our iniquity was laid on him, and by with his stripes we are healed. I'm just mixing the words up, I think. But okay. Mm-hmm. Chapter 6 and verses 38 through 40. Yes.
Okay.
Verses 38 through 40.
"For I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise up it again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day."
You get the idea that God's pleasure is good for people. In other words, will means pleasure. And what God wants the Son to do is really good for us. Now, Christian, it's a singular concept that I wanted to emphasize this morning. And now, I have in the New Testament perhaps more than 100 verses where this same word for pleasure, speaking of God, are used. You'd be amazed what a fruitful study it would be if you would look at it. And one of the things that I would infer is that God's pleasure should be my pleasure. God's pleasure ought to be my pleasure. When you go to Chick-fil-A and you order a sandwich and they deliver it and you say, "Thank you," you got the sandwich you wanted and it was their pleasure to give it to you. And if it wasn't their pleasure to get it to you, then they need a new Chick-fil-A worker. You never notice they usually have happy workers at Chick-fil-A. I don't think I've gone to Chick-fil-A and had unhappy workers, right? If I owned Chick-fil-A and there was an unhappy worker, I would be pleased to find a happy worker instead of an unhappy one. And it's a good way to live. Now, Christian, let me just remind you of this truth that we found in the Scripture this morning. And that is that God's will, that we are created in life for God's pleasure. And that in order to perform God's pleasure, it ought to please us. So many times we think that if we do what God wants, we just won't like it. We just won't be happy. And I'm going to just tell you, you're believing bad things about God. Things that aren't true about His pleasure. As though, who was it that said something that used the word? Is it good? What did you say? What is it?
Entertainment.
Yeah, that we're created for God's entertainment. And the reality of it is, we could understand some of the concept of that, but God's not playing. Not playing games. But I am thrilled to death, are you not, that actually what I do on earth can affect God in heaven, and for Him not only to be pleased, but that can cause God pleasure or bring him pleasure. Now, wouldn't you like to please God this week? Wouldn't you like to just have heaven move with pleasure this week? I promise you, if the honest answer, as the Holy Spirit searches your heart and as your heart's motive is revealed to you, if the honest answer is no, I wouldn't like to please God, I'd like to please myself, that you have misjudged God and that you will miss not only God's will for your life, but you'll miss pleasurable living. We talked about Paul. We talked about he was the model of misery. Honestly, if you think about the things he had to do, things he went through, do you know that God's will for Paul's life absolutely positively suited him for the way that God created him and made him to be? God didn't make you to be the Apostle Paul. He didn't make you to be the person sitting next to you. He made you to be the person sitting in your seat. And I promise to you that if your pleasure is God's pleasure, you'll have a happy life. Father, thank you for what we've learned this morning. And I pray that you would help us to have the faith to believe sometimes things that, because of sinful hearts and really a sin nature, it's not in our flesh to understand. And I pray, Lord, that as a result of this, some of us would have experiences beyond what we would have dreamed for your pleasure. We pray to your glory in Jesus' name.